All right, I'm Gav. I'm not ex Barmy Army. I'm always the Aussie Army. But let's start with telling you how stupid I felt this morning. Not that I've not felt stupid. I felt stupid millions of times in my life. But this morning, I got up at 7:30, and I know that the match starts at 5 o'clock in Australia, in Melbourne. So 7 o'clock they take lunch. 7:40 they'll come back, something like that. I get up, I make my tea, and I sit down. I turn on the television, and I'm like, let's watch some fucking carnage. And it says highlights. You want to see highlights? I'm like, these kind of things Sony television does. I was like, I went back. I was like, lives. He said, you want to watch highlights? And I'm like, finally it dawns upon me. He's like, motherfucker, these guys are all out. They must have lost my innings. This is crazy stuff. And then I go in and I'm like, this guy who debuted today, Boland, he has bowled the fuck out of them. The guy took six wickets for what, 7 runs or something like that?
Yeah,
absolutely crazy. Like, did he even give CS 7 runs and 4 overs, 6 wickets? My goodness. It just completely blew my mind. And as they've been saying, there's a bit of a, you know, gif going around. Or the funny part is, like, whosoever takes 5 wickets in the match does not play the next match. Cummins took the 5 wickets in the first, 5 wickets haul, did not play in the next match. Richardson took 5 wicket haul, did not play the next match. Now, Boland's going to be dropped as well. I mean, we all know England is shit, right? Like, literally, I put my hands in their pants. And there was nothing. Like, even the ding-dong was, like, very small. The ball part wasn't there. Like, just completely missing. It just has happened. What were they expecting when they're going to put Hasif Hamid? People like, I'm not trolling Hasif Hamid. I'm just saying the only reason this guy is there is because of his Asian descent and also minority within minority. That's why he was selected. And Jack Crawley, he just looked like the guy who is actually averaging 11. And just to update you on that, his averages are now 10 for year 2011. 2021. So it has gone further down. Once you're averaging 11 and you get recalled for the test and you have just fall down further, man, that's not rock bottom. That's something else altogether. That's Charlie Sheen stuff. That's Charlie Sheen stuff in 2013 when he got dropped from his own show. Man, this is bad shit. And let's just talk about what happened to England. Third day, first session, it's all over. Australia's already won 3-0. The only reason England can actually salvage something is because Australia is just going to take their foot off the paddle. It's just a natural thing, right? I really can't see how this English team, I mean, that is embarrassing and there's this. This is England. They made this, they created this cricket. Australia hadn't played for a year. You have played only 17 matches. You have all the practice and then what the fuck just happened?
Yeah, and they had a rotation as well, right? They were rotating players 10 months back when they traveled to India. People were not playing just to be fresh for Ashes. I don't know what type of preparation they were trying to have. It's like, it's so many records have been broken today that it's not even funny.
They're tied with their own record of 54 ducks in a season, in a calendar year.
Yeah.
I mean, embarrassment is they didn't break it. I think they would be like, you know, we could have done 55. I think there's been a lot of talks about that in 2022. They want to do the 55.
It would have happened. It would have happened if we had played the last test match in England. I think it would have happened. Because
Like 52. It was like a tier, like, you know, edge of the seat thriller. It was 52 ducks. And then 3 wickets to go. Then Mark Wood gets out on a duck. Then Ollie Robinson gets out on a duck. It's 54. And James Anderson had to take those 2 runs before he got out. Come on, James White. Show some bloody respect,
yeah,
Mike.
I mean,
you've already taken so many wickets. You need to show some respect. I don't know where to start, where to end.
Doesn't even score 300 and they win by a innings against a full test-playing nation. This is just bizarre. Never happened. I think even Bangladesh has not lost so badly. So
that's a good point. They didn't actually make 300. They actually made 267, like, which is far away from 300. It's just how much did England make? 68. Yeah, 68.
68.
Could have just made 69. At least the score would have looked nicer.
Yeah, and as a ex Barmy Army member now, I think I've. I have lost all any chance of trolling any team ever after this drubbing. I mean, what can I say? And there are two test matches still to go. One of them is a pink ball test. And yeah, I don't know, like, who will they bring in? They might, I mean, as you said,
I think nobody wants to come in. They don't want their careers to be destroyed because of this thing. Another reason I was saying I was stupid, because I had told you in the first podcast also, or offline as well, that now the next 5 days, from 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, like, it will be just matches galore. Like, you know, it starts at 5 o'clock, finishes at 1, and then you take a half an hour lunch break, and then the match starts again and just finishes around 10 o'clock or something like that. But no, this match is already over. On the first morning, I couldn't even see anything. Okay, because I don't want to wake up at 5 o'clock, right? And then second day was washed out for India. South Africa were fucking shit on the first day. They came back today, but isn't it already too little, too late? It's just why is South Africa following England? Like, you know, it's their country. Where's the firepower? You're supposed to do that to India. India has never beaten South Africa ever, like, in the history, like, not even in the 20th century BC. They've never done it. And now, yeah, it just looks like they're just waking up. Like, English just wake up. Like, you know, all the three matches, England has done the same thing, right? They go so far behind and then they start waking up. And there's this flicker of hope. And then they get whipped in the ass. Boom, 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 boom. And they get completely destroyed. That flicker is the hope. It's like they're the perfect metaphor for this. Hope is what kills you.
Yeah, correct, correct.
And the hope is like, hope is what kills you.
Not Shea Hope from West Indies. I think I don't know, like, this, it can happen in one test match, two test matches maybe, but by the time third test match rolls in, at least, you know, should have some knowledge about the condition. You have already played so much there, and you all are professional cricketers. It's not like some club team rolling in. So yeah, it just, I mean, there was a tweet about England lost the Ashes in 11 days, under 12 days. They were in quarantine for longer than that. That's
because there's a time, last time they actually lost it in 11 days. That was the earliest they have lost. But I think they have lost this even earlier, because I think people are not counting that in Adelaide. It was raining, so they lost a lot of overs there.
Yeah.
And there was a little bit of, in the first match in Brisbane, they lost very, very early. In Adelaide, they showed a lot of fight. I think Adelaide, because it went to the fifth day, Josh Butler, you know, was dropped because Gary did not take him he would have gotten like double ducks or whatever that's called, diamond duck or something, in the test match. And then eventually, like, you know, once everything was going fine, he just had to kick his own stumps. I mean, there's a comedy of errors and then there's just pure comedy. That's the English team. It's crazy, like, how everything is turned, like, whatever could go wrong for them has gone wrong. And whatever could go right for Australia has gone right. It's just like, whosoever comes in for Australia just seems like the greatest player ever in the history. And whosoever comes in for England feels like, you know, they've never held the bat in their life. What has happened?
Yeah, and in all this slander, because everyone is picking on England, but if we have to come back to Australia as well and think about the captaincy, right? We have been saying again and again that captaincy matters, and you can clearly see this is the same team, similar team, like almost similar team which played against India, right? And the same team under a different captain. It's just you know, they're relentless, right? They're completely relentless, and it's just a different team under Cummins' captaincy, and it's a very amazing change, right? Generally, you drop a bowler. You change. You retain batsmen, and all the focus is on batting, and if the captain is a batsman itself. But they got a new bowler in because he is from that same place. It's his hometown, and he just comes in and takes six wickets. So there is something there in his captaincy which is bringing out really good performances out of everyone. And again, England,
I think it's just off field also. It's not just on field, because he was just being there one day. But when he started, he took 5 wickets straight away. He came in this match, I think he took the first 3 wickets, then he did not take a wicket. But that's because sometimes that thing happens. But he bowled really, really well. Everybody just kind of destroyed them. So those things do happen. But like, if, for example, like everybody talks shit about Mitchell Stark, right? Before they doesn't deserve to be in the team, blah, all that nonsense. Now, who's the highest wicket taker? Who's the one who's actually standing up for everything? He's taken 14 wickets. And on top of that, you know how much he's averaging in while batting? His averaging is 58.5. Like, it's not a joke. He's averaging 58.5. Stephen Smith is averaging 31. And Labuschagne, who's been the best batsman, is averaging 57. And Mitchell Stark is averaging 58. So, just everybody just stood up. It's crazy.
Yeah, that's the I think that's the difference, right? Mitchell Stark, everyone was saying that he's finished, he's over. All he has always been under the scanner, and now you have a captain who I think trusts him, right? He opens the bowling, Mitchell Stark, and he's I think he would be enjoying right now, right? Enjoying playing in this team, and even though there are so many critics around him. But it would just feel to have a captain who understands you, because they would be great mates, right? They are bowling partners, so they would be great mates outside of the cricket ground as well. So yeah, it definitely the captaincy has made a huge impact in Australia's case, and sadly for England, I don't think Root can do anything. I mean, he can't be a magician, right?
Yeah, he's still the highest scorer in the series by far. Like, apart from him, there's like nobody. I mean, David Malan has also scored 202, but then apart from that, it's like it's just been pretty terrible. It's like people haven't even scored 100 runs throughout the series, and the three matches have already gone. I don't know what else to talk about them except that it's pretty much over. But the only reason England can salvage something is because, you know, once, like, they've already destroyed them, so naturally, the human nature, you kind of like, you're not as fired up because it's already done and dusted. Mm. But I think Australia will still come out, but there is a chance England might look less horrible. Also, there's a lot of the Omicron drama is happening. So it is possible that they might just play next two matches in Melbourne itself, which is going to be crazy. But then we've done that in Ahmedabad in India, right? All the matches in one place. It is possible because if they feel there's any chance of, like, you know, matches not going ahead, then they'll definitely end up playing in Melbourne, which will be super weird. But all the Melbourneites will definitely love it. Particularly
one Scott Boland will get two more matches, I guess. Because
Richardson. Richardson and Nisa will not be out. Nisa, like, what the fuck is happening, mate? What the fuck is sucks? My life sucks. It's just my life sucks. It's been incredible. Ashes series. It's been the way they've been decimated. It's just, I don't know. I don't know how they'll come back from it. A lot of careers will be finished. And they have to just plant the balls. It's about time, man. It's about time. It's just completely showcasing the difference between real cricket and, you know, the entertainment cricket as the T20 goes.
Yeah, correct, exactly. I don't think we can even blame that, because even Australia has a very successful T20 league, right? Big Bash is so popular. All the players play in it, and most of the Australians play in IPL. So it's not like, you know, it's just an English problem that they are focused or... T20, the shorter format of cricket is more popular. I mean, it's not more popular in Australia, because in Australia they love test matches. But yeah, it's just, I don't know. I mean, it's just lack of application or whatever. I think it's just a system, as I think we were talking about, that the domestic system has to be in place, which can keep producing quality cricketers. And it's just not happening, I think, in England's case. At least in batting department, because I think bowling wise they are doing decent. I don't think doing well. In fact, not even decent. I don't think that is a question. Whatever they have been able to compete in the series is due to bowling. So I think bowling is fine. It's just the batting.
All right, we're gonna move on from England and we're gonna move on to India just quickly. Next 5 minutes on India, what's happening there? I completely agree. Bowling is perfectly fine. Batting, I don't think it's application. It's just talent. They don't have any talent. They don't have any talent. They don't have any balls. There's nothing there. Like, literally, I put my hands, like, in all their pants.